Good morning, ladies and gentlemen, and welcome to the evaluation of Eivind Tveter's PhD work. My name is Harald Gjelle. I'm a professor of transport economics, and I'm head of the PhD logistics program. And I'm going to chair this event. This is a great day for Molde University College. It's a great day for the candidate himself, but also for colleagues and family and friends. The evaluation day is organized as follows. We'll start with a trial lecture in a few minutes. Then we'll break until 1:15. Given that the trial lecture is approved, the defense will commence at 1:15 p.m. In principle, there is no time limit for the defense. I would now like to present the candidate and the adjudication committee. Eivind Tveter, aged 38, is born in Lillehammer, Norway. He holds a Master of Economics from the University of Oslo in 2006. During his PhD work, he has been employed as a researcher at Møreforskning Molde, where he has worked since 2012. He has earlier worked in the research department of Statistics Norway and as a consultant in Analyse og Strategi. His PhD work has been funded by Møreforskning Fund, Molde University College, and the National Public Roads Authorities. And the title of his thesis is 4 Essays on the Wider Economic Benefits of Transport Improvements. His main supervisor has been Professor Svein Brotten from Molde University College. The members of the adjudication committee are Professor Stephen Gibbons from London School of Economics, and senior lecturer Dr. Helena Boman from the University of Malmö in Sweden. And the chair of the committee is Professor Johan Holmgren from Molde University College. Now on to the trial lecture. That is the last obstacle before the candidate is given the opportunity to defend his PhD thesis. The lecture should last approximately 45 minutes, and it should prove that the candidate is able to structure and present the specific topic which was given to the candidate 10 work days ahead of the presentation. There will be no questions asked to the trial lecture. After the lecture is finished, the committee will
I'm going to go to the next one. Times larger than using the car was mainly for going to other cities in off-peak hours in leisure activities. So this is two examples of transport networks, transport systems, and my use of it in two different cities. At least in the Norwegian context, this is a typical small city, the city of Molde, while Oslo is our largest city. So how can we say something about which system or which city that has the best performing system? How can we ask and answer such question? So the transport system performance, that's a really big and large question. I will not deal with this large question in this lecture.
It's too complicated. And also because it's probably not a definitive answer to tell you something about the performance of the transport system. But there are different ways to tackle this problem. We will try to analyze how the system uses or inputs these outputs in the transport system. That's one way to do it. But the way I propose to analyze transport systems in this system is to use a more theoretical based approach and looking towards which types of market failures are existing in transport systems and how will such market failures differ between cities or different types. So, let's define what we mean by a transport system. And one way to define a transport system is that it's not only one transport network, for example, what transport network might be one network of roads, but it includes all types of networks, the roads, all the networks with rails,
after a few times, the first values, but in addition to the network, the transport system, it is all supported infrastructure, the stations, the bus stop, and all underlying infrastructure that support the system. So what is the objective of transport system? Important to understand. So the objective is to provide mobility opportunities for the people in a city or between cities, and also a system that provides an efficient distribution of goods and freight to firms, between firms, and also to the end consumer. So, in this picture, you see here, it looks like it's sunny, and it seems like the systems are working quite nicely. Is that that how it always is? But it's not always first. Sometimes networks might be congested, especially the roads. And roads being congested means that when you see the road, that is particularly in the peak hour time, when people are driving to their office or home again from their office, the start time might be several times longer than in a peak time. So that's the problem with congestion. I think the answer for the economist is that this can be seen as a waste of resources. People are using many, many millions of hours standing in a line. And for these hours, we probably have a better usage. For example, to people work more hours at their office or enjoy some leisure activities. So, another issue with transport systems, especially roads, is that they have environmental costs. Cars are emitting CO2, which has a cost to CO2 emissions. And this is unintended consequence of the usage of the road system, which is a step that the users on the road do not necessarily account for when they choose how much to use the transport system, and the roads in particular. Also, the distance might cause accidents, which also is an unintended effect. This has costs for the people involved and also for society. The system might also be crowded, such as here in a metro. Here, the problem is not necessarily that you get more slowly to your office because the travel time of the metro is dependent on how crowded the electric cars are, but it might have some negative effects for people using it, and maybe not all people can get inside the metro cars. So another issue with transport systems is not necessarily a cost or a perceived problem as we saw earlier, but the fact that most transport systems and transport networks have economies of scale, and that means that for example, building a metro system, it during career or initial investment, while the additional cost for one person to use the system is very, very low and could be sometimes seen as zero, while one more people are passenger will use the system. In these cases, there will be decreasing average cost. That means that the average cost in small cities, if you have a metro system, will be much higher than the average cost in a large system. And then we could ask, is it suitable for all different cities to have such infrastructure, such as a metro system. So, what do all these issues have in common? There are a lot of things in common, but what I will point to here is that there are examples of market failures, which give inefficiency losses. So the idea here, at least from the standard welfare economic point of view, is that a competitive economy where there are no market failures and a market for good and full information, the outcome of the competition in such a system will give the best possible welfare outcome for the people in the economy. But if there are present inefficiency or market failures, this will not longer be the case. these two market failures I will point to in this lecture is scale economies and externalities, which is effects in the market system, which which in principle will affect how efficient the system will function. Now we look at three different market failures. There are others that I could study, but I have chosen three. I will look at the scale economies in urban bus transport. I will look at congestion externalities. And I will look at the scale externalities in network systems. First, the scale economies in urban bus transport, which is known as the mooring effect in transport economies. The mooring effect has its name from mooring, an American economist that wrote a classical paper in 1972 where he explained this effect. So the idea behind the mooring effect is that in a large city, there will be high frequency of the bus service. This will decrease the travel time for passengers, which is a positive effect in travel costs for passengers. But for the providers of this buses, this effect will not be accounted for in a case of a character, we need to account for such effects when they set up the scheduling and the practice of all the bus routes. So let's take a little more analytical look at the mooring effect. So we are using math and quantitative diagrams. I speak to the simplest possible way to explain the mooring effect. So if we start by assuming that there are constant return to scale in the production of the services, constant return to scale means if if we double the input for producing bus services, the output will double. So, for example, if we double the number of buses and then double the number of bus drivers, production of bus services will double and the cost will also double. The second assumption we will use is that the travel cost for the bus consists of 3 months. It consists of the ticket price, and it also includes the cost of waiting time at the bus stop. Our third assumption is that passengers arrive randomly at the bus stop. How do we interpret this assumption? We can look at this assumption as for example, when passengers do not know the bus schedule, they will arrive randomly. But another, maybe more likely way to get this assumption through is to different. The bus frequency is so high that people will not bother to check the schedule. Our assumption is that the service frequency will be proportional to demand, which means that if the demand for the services double, the frequency of the buses will also. We also assume that there are no congestion on the road. So, given this rather strict assumptions, what happens if the city size doubles? If the city size doubles, then demand will be doubling and frequency doubles according to our assumption. But time production and cost double. And since costs and the passengers are both at the same increases at the same rate, there will be no effect on the average cost for per passenger. And therefore, there are no reason to expect that ticket prices should change after the doubling of the city size. But what happens for the passengers? For the passengers, there will then be no change to ticket price, but the waiting time will be cut in half because the frequency doubles, and this travel cost decrease for the passengers. So the effect is that the benefit, the change benefit for the passengers is different than the change in cost for the user. And this will not be accounted for in a private competition solution, and this means that this will maximize the cost problem. So this assumption that don't really are rather realistic and unrealistic. A paper published in 2008 showed that under other assumption the whole effect disappears and claimed that this shows that the more effect is not relevant. In a follow-up paper by two known transport economists, it was shown that these stress effects will appear under all related accepts or assumptions. How should we connect this scale effect to the city size? If we again picture our very strict assumption, this And the government should be able to pay us for the time we spend working on the bus. And I do take the cost of this is that surprise yourself that subsidies is the independent of the tax. And this then means that this type of market failure should not be very different for different spices of cities. But not the data tell us. So if we look at the case in Norway, we found that cities, the counties, so it's not directly related to city size, but the way these data are published. And here you can see that the are a positive relationship between the amount of subsidies and population size in the different countries. But then we have different, many different explanations. Subsidies might not be so optimal. It's other effects that the services. But at least if we look at the largest country, which is Oslo and Akershus, if we can see some the idea of the more at least on the district assumptions, because the amount of subsidies in the largest affecting the largest county are not very different. So our second market failure, congestion. So one way to look at congestion is that on a given road, we have a capacity for a vehicle and a transfer for the vehicle using the road. When the traffic volume is far away from capacity, it will follow the allowed speed limit, then the train approaches the capacity, so the time will will increase and the speed will decrease. So, how could we think about the effect of this phenomenon? The congestion is an element of externality. So, in the typical urban network, congested. So, how can you think about congestion? Is it a problem? Should you do something about it? And here, one of the messages of congestion is that when people are choosing to use a congestion road, they will not account for the fact that they will make the road more congested for everybody. To be really specific, for example, the car up here, he will account for the fact that he will marginally affect the congestion by using the road, but he will not account for the fact that all the cars following behind him will be marginally slower. I think this effect is applied to all the people that cross the road, the congestion will be higher than the cost in terms of congestion will be higher than the benefit for the car users. So how can we think about congestion in Norway and how is the difference between the three cities? So, in quite recent, there are US and attack tools in Norway. Here we can see how the government in different cities try to deal with congestion. And why do we use tolls? there's the limit to how can be within the constraints of a system. So that system really what is the preferred way according to economists is to deal with the projection by pricing the system out using the price system directly but using tools around the world. So here you can see in Oslo, these rates are much higher than when I lived in Oslo. And it's it will be quite an expense to use the cost for daily driving in Oslo and Berlin. And one interesting feature here is that although Oslo is a much larger city than Berlin, the size of all the hotels, which can be interpreted as the size of the externality, is actually quite of people in Berlin and Oslo. But of course, we do not know that this sort of not necessarily the optimal. Optimal types, but if they were those optimal types,
could be one way to think about these types of the externality. So if we look at the traffic flow in Oslo, our capital, and use map data from Google, which they collect by taking from all our GPS signals when we drive around with our mobile phones. We can get an impression of traffic flow in the whole system in Oslo. And here you can see that when people typically drive home from work, the overall road network is
congested in all road links in the Oslo. How does this look like in a small city as in Molde? In Molde, we have one time of the day, we have another congestion at 8:45. In the morning, at least if we believe this Google data, if I cannot check myself, but this is the way people are speaking about projection in morning. So there's one small congestion in Norway, but this totally adapted. There are only 45 minutes after, and in all other cities, the road network in Molde is uncongested. So, in Molde, congestion is a large problem, at least when we compare to Oslo. So, is it the best least true that congestion is something that is proportional to city size? Well, not necessarily. If we look at Copenhagen, the capital of Denmark, which is a larger city than Oslo, almost twice as big, the overall congestion in this city is it's lower than for Oslo. So what's the reason? Probably there are many explanations, but the problem most important one is that they have an alternative transport mode, which is more attractive than in Oslo, because in Copenhagen, using a bicycle is for many people the fastest way to fastest way to get along, while in Oslo, the city is not suitable to use bicycles, not that much more things than is recognized. So, let's look at our third market failure, scale economies, or economies of scale, which is the problem of average cost. The economies of scale is something that is prevailing in all types of transport. This is one of the main reasons why the government are responsible for the transport networks, because due to the scale economies, the largest firm is always able to produce the service most cheaply. And the market solution will then tend to end up in a monopoly situation. In a monopoly, the only producer could set prices. To set prices higher than the optimal solution and set them in inefficient limits. So this type of scale economies is one, this the market power is one element of scale economies, but another is the market size. When we think about the transport, because a master system needs some market. What I would say here, if we, for example, look at average cost, demand and profit volume, or tax rate further, we assume average costs that are decreasing in the whole range in this figure, and we have a demand schedule for control, which is demand for the use of the metro system, which is decreasing in the price. In this case, it's possible to find a solution where if prices is equal to T1, traffic volume will be equal to D1, and this is instant where the revenue generated by the system will equal the cost for the system. So here we can provide the metro service without using
optimal solution, because prices should be set to marginal cost, so we should have slightly more traffic, but the general idea is that the system could operate without substantial
amounts of subsidies. But if we instead take the city as Norden, which is much less, not the same size, and if we should have the same ticket prices in our Norden metro as in Oslo, this system would require enormous subsidies to be operated. So this is one way to think about scale economies and when different types of transport systems is provided in cities of different sizes. How does the different cities map up with the trams and the metros? Here you can see the six population of six largest cities in Norway. And we see that in only one city, the capital, there's a subway system, while there's a tram system in the three highest cities. And this distribution is supposed to stop the same pattern as we saw at the diagram of the previous slide. So maybe this means that Oslo is the only city which is large enough to provide a metro system, and only three of the cities are large enough to provide trams or maybe also these three small cities are on the margin to be large enough to Bergen, this system where it was down, although they were being quite early, they were closed down in different periods. In 2009, the system that were closed down opened again a few years after, but this the system that is used now is much smaller than the original system. And in Bergen, the system was closed down much earlier and totally removed and only rebuilt again from scratch for a couple of years now. The reasons for this is, for example, that at least in the Bergen case, that in 1965, cars became available, which they were being used for the transport. This new transport mode less attractive than the four cars were available. So let's summarize this lecture. We have discussed the performance of transport systems and cities. We have interpreted performance in terms of economic efficiency by looking at how different market failures are related to transport systems and how these market failures differ between cities of different types. In particular, we have looked at fuel economies in urban bus transport. We have looked at congestion externalities. We have looked at scale economies in the production in our metro system. And we, the overall answer to our analysis is that there are no deterministic relationship between city size and the size of these externalities. And then the main one reason that we cannot show any clear pattern is that these externalities are interdependent. Here I looked at bus transport, road transport, metro transport in isolation. But these may also have mutual dependence. For example, for a large city, there might be important scale economies in buses, but when the city increases in size, the roads will be congested, and if it decreases enough, maybe the scale economies is large enough to provide a metro system. But this is large question, but this is one way to deal with this broad question. So finally, the main sources used in this lecture are a couple of old books and some scholarly research paper and some web resources. Thank you for your attention.
Thank you again for the presentation. I have a commitment to the prior lecture, and I'm here for me when I continue again with the presentation on the defense at 1:15 p.m. You are welcome to join us again in the same room. Thank you. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. I'm going to go to the next
Welcome to the defense of Eventuator's thesis. The defense will now proceed in the order of sequence decided upon by the committee.
For this part, so this could go on for a while.
Thank you.
So the principally controlled, I just tried pushing as data and found that the amount of data was not, it was far too small to even understand how the support region support properties and stuff like that just jumped around. So with so few data points, I did not consider that. But I have a sensitivity analysis using a regression framework in the second paper. And there I show that the effects are, they are similar, but I feel that they are, they hide some of the uncertainties that we see with the synthetic controls, where the matching is not perfect, and we can interpret which municipalities that are actually used in matching procedure, which I found as a quite good property of the synthetic control method, that you can, the counterfactual is made by a few cases, and they have some percentage points attached to them, and you can, if you are really, if you know the Norwegian economy well, you can examine whether it's like it's likely that these are good controls. But of course, that's very difficult for you, for example,
very well done. I mean, I was going to say, yes, I mean, this is a sort of strength and a weakness. Because you wind up with two regions, and you've got to buy this idea that these two regions somehow, an average of them, looked exactly like, you know, the treatment region.
Yeah.
And I don't know, you know, looking at it, something that I know, like, it's an example where Heroi is, it's one of your treatments, and it's an average of two other regions called Sun and Aram. I don't know. Like, people actually, it's an average of these two regions, it's looking like this one, without any other. Basically that's it. You've just got a simple average almost, because they've got equal weights each, and you're saying, well, these two regions just weighted 50-50 look exactly like this other region in terms of what I would expect in the future trends, right? Which is, you know, sometimes can, you might think that's a strength, you might think it's stretching credibility.
Yeah, so it's, for example, I read one of the papers from the developers of this model. They have tried to estimate impact of the German unification. And there they use countries, which has a nice property that more people know about something about different countries. But they, for example, they include Norway in their dollar pool, but it shouldn't be there at all because of our discovery of oil and our special economy. So they obviously do not know the Norwegian economy well enough when choosing their donor pool, and these are very good researchers. So I guess it's both a strength and a weakness.
Yeah, just one further point, picking up on something you said there. That's a strength of it, which I suppose you could do by other methods, but strength of it, you get these area-specific effects. You know, from the different treatment regions, you're getting a separate result, which is quite useful in some ways. But how would somebody, a policymaker, how would they generalise from that to understanding the benefits that they would expect for a project in a different scenario? What would be the way? Because normally, somebody is just looking for a number, right?
Yeah,
they can apply it
so
in their context. What advice would you give to someone who's wanting to know how to interpret your results for their own purposes?
For example, if we take my second paper, which is a fixed link in between two, at least in the Norwegian sense or situation, two medium small cities. So then this result will be interesting for connecting other small cities in Norway that are roughly in the same range. From being 1.5 hours down to 30%, which is the next fixed links that we maybe will build, but it's not directly transferable to more urban areas directly, but it will at least say something about how propensities to commute are in the Norwegian situation between when you decrease travel times from 1 hour to half an hour, but so maybe useful in some other areas, but not in the most densely populated areas in Molde or the UK, but in Scotland, for example, there are a couple of cases that are all the same type. So
that's the drawback with this case-based analysis, that the generality of the results are
Thank you. I'm going to go to the next one. Thank you.
points that we think is negative, because I'm trying to target the time is really important for you. You know, you might have some design to deal with that. You think it's a component of the time and you're trying to consult the past time. How do you feel that you think this is not sort of the test that comes to growth in prices, but what is expected growth in decline in the outcome that you're investigating? You know, I'm not just trying to tell you what the sort of, you know, jobs that are done in each one of the settled and, is it the only way to do some price to the other one if you need to do a step by the public for dollars for the work? And from the last thing to me, can this matter external factors so that we could do it with the picture of the project as well? And I just begin to say, I'm going to be nice to have a project distance from distance analysis that I've created out of
that's why I think it's interesting to the Thank you. I'm going to go to the next slide. I'm going to be a little bit of a Thank you. Gracias. Thank you. Because of what they say and why, just that the case that the effort that you're doing Thank you. We Thank you. When you estimate the effect in the first paper, the effect of density, then it's the same effect everywhere?
Yeah, that's only the average effect across the whole country. Yeah, that's true. But since I only have the transport network from 2005 and 2009, it's I cannot use more data points than from 2009 and 2005, which at least is, makes it impossible to use the, or not the best idea to use the synthetic control method in that that paper.
Mm. Yeah, I was just thinking about maybe models where you let the effect vary between different places or context. I mean, you do some robustness checks where you divide the material somewhat.
Yeah. So letting them depend on.
Well, yeah. Do you have any suggestions?
So one obvious thing that should be accounted for is that it's different which year or how much the networks are affected in each case. So in some way should account for some treatment intensity, for example. And also the years when they were constructed also differs, which also should, in principle, should be accounted for in the analysis.
Okay, I think when you talk about commuting, and Stephen were into this issue also. But you say that it's commuting and studying commuting can be used as an indirect approach to test for agglomeration economies. If agglomeration economies effect have occurred, I think you say. And so is it enough to conclude that commuting has changed to conclude that you have agglomeration economies?
No. So the point I tried to make there with lacks one part is that in my understanding, you can think about these effects as first you need to have a change in city size or the sales to labor market, and then you have to show some positive relationship between productivity and the city size. So in the Eiksund paper, I only considered the first step, whether the city size is affected by the transport improvement. But I also need to assume that there's a positive relationship between productivity and city size for the effects to occur. But if there are no effect on city size, then it will, according to this argument, prove that there is no agglomeration effect, although there is a positive relationship between city size and productivity.
Yeah, I think you argued well why it's interesting, but I think just in a small section there in the paper, it seemed like if I find this,
I lacked one step in that.
Okay.
I think we talk about elasticities sometimes, and we talk about the effects in terms of the user benefits sometimes. Because during your presentation and your defense here, you have at one point said that the effects, the agglomeration effects, are in line with international results, and at another point you said that they were substantially lower than in other countries. So, which should we?
Substantial.
You mentioned that in the UK there were 10-30% of the user benefits.
International range, although it is at the lower end, but if we only look at the international range of 10-50%, it's more than what it is at least, but it's just a very important I think that's
in thinking
about for some time, but one of the benefits we can get in proportion to the
Thank you.